weeks, and especially over the last few days, we've been pushing very hard to increase the capacity of the labs where in Lagos and Abuja, because that's where most of the cases are. But we've rolled out 5 new labs in the last couple of weeks. Kano has just been activated yesterday. So we're not sitting down. This is a very vigorous process. It's called a PCR testing process. When people hear about a test, they think about, you know, the HIV test or a pregnancy test where you put it in, it tells you yes or no. Unfortunately, this is a lot more complex, and explaining it sometimes is a little bit difficult, but it takes about 5-6 hours to run. Everything is carefully diluted, and you know, you can't stop that run until you complete. So it's a complex process, but Nigeria should rest assured that there's no bigger priority that we have now than to improve and increase our testing capacity, because we know that is what it will take.
Okay, fine. We'll still come back to our testing capacity. Mm. Meanwhile, let's take a short break and we'll be back.
Okay, so what's going on now is very distracting to me as well. I literally have no more.
Okay, welcome back. We're talking about Nigeria's capacity to test for COVID-19. And we're here with Dr. Chikwe Ihekweazu. I'm very sorry. You're talking about testing capacity, but let's go back. It means that our inability to test, would it mean the lockdown will likely proceed?
The lockdown is Mr. President's decision, and he's alone to make. Of course, the data we will provide the presidency will include what the work we've done over the last couple of weeks, how we've increased our testing capacity, how we'll continue to work along those lines. But he will also get information from many other parts of society, from the state governments, from our treatment centers, how many do we now have, many aspects of this response. So yes, the ability to test more people is definitely one important factor that will lead into his decision making. But, you know, I think the key thing about the lockdown, you know, when I met Mr. President the first time, the decision to lock down wasn't one that came easy to him. You know, he really thought hard and long about the consequences, the price many Nigerians will pay, the difficulties that they will face in their daily lives. He understood very clearly, and this was really the topic of most of his questions, was how would we survive this, given the realities of the 200 million people that he leads. So, you know, at the end of the day, it was a hard decision, but he was also clear that this is a decision we had to make, because for that long-term prosperity to continue, for us to have the ability to, you know, to get on with our lives, we have to go through some pain in the short term. And that's the pain and the challenge that many Nigerians have gone through over the last 2 weeks. And we've used that opportunity to really scale our work. Lagos State, kudos to them. They've done an extraordinary job. As in Lagos this week with the presidential task force, we went around the treatment centers in Lagos, and you know, they've done an incredible job, because one thing is about testing. But if you don't have the facilities to bring in the patients once you've tested, then there's no point in testing. So together, across federal and state levels, across all aspects of society, we've worked very hard to make the best out of this opportunity. And I hope and pray And I'm sure that this sacrifice will be necessary and lead us to even a better future.
So as it is now, many poor Nigerians don't know how long this sacrifice would lead them. So we don't know as it is now how long and how much Nigerian will have to sacrifice.
Yeah, Doshima, to be honest, I don't know either, right? I know that with or without the end breaking of the lockdown, our work will have to continue because we are not at the end of this outbreak. So yes, Mr. President has to decide what the circumstances are, but our work will continue tomorrow morning with or without the lockdown.
Okay, some Nigerians have expressed concern at the arrival of the Chinese medical team. What difference will that make compared to what your team is doing on ground so far?
Yeah, so, you know, this has been a very unfortunately controversial issue. You know, yes, the virus started from China, right? But there's no country in the world that has been more successful in controlling this outbreak and bringing numbers down to China. And this is a global outbreak. No country can do this on its own. There's a lot of nationalism in our commentary, and I understand where that is coming from. But the truth is, we can't do this on our own, right? So if there's help coming from one country, China is not the only country that has offered help. Tomorrow, I'll be in Lagos to receive a big consignment from the United Nations. Many countries have come together to donate through that. So we're getting help from many sources. This is just one part of it. And everything they've brought into the country will be useful for the response. And Nigerians must trust their leaders in this regard. None of us has, our interest is to get the support we need in order to control the outbreak, in order for life to return as usual, as normal. And that's really what we're focused on doing.
Okay, we have a mandatory isolation, self-isolation policy here. Mm-hmm. Are they observing this mandatory isolation?
Absolutely, they are. They are observing this. We went to inspect it. My team was there. And we'll continue to supervise that isolation. You know, they're here because they want to support. They're participants in the Nigerian economy, just like we are participants in the Chinese economy, to different scales because we're at different points in our development journey.
So where are they and where are they, that's where are they right now? What part of the country are they? And
they're somewhere in Abuja. You know, we would never comment on specifics. I wouldn't do that for a Nigerian. I wouldn't do that for a Chinese national. But yeah, they're here to help. We're grateful for their help. And we're grateful for the government of China. Listen, from the beginning of this outbreak, we've been in touch with the government of China. They've been in touch with my Minister of Health, just like he's been in touch with many other leaders across the world. And we're working together. Almost every day I'm on teleconferences with leaders across the world. We have to learn from each other. None of us has this ability somewhere to find all the solutions. So really, we live in a global village, both in terms of transmission, like we've seen this virus has gone from country to country, but also in terms of the response. Because what we learn in one country will help us respond in another. And so we're interconnected in so many different ways. And, you know, Nigerians need to let go a little bit of the anxieties. We will do our very best to make sure only the safest products and services are there for them. That's our role as leaders. And we will not drop the ball in making sure we carry out this responsibility.
Okay, these experts are few. And many are wondering, how are they going to be shared among the states with the highest number of COVID-19?
Nobody is sharing them. You know, they came in with some equipment. They're going to train the trainers, so train the other Nigerians that will now be deploying this equipment to different sites as has been previously agreed. So this is not like the Jack Ma donation that had to be shared for every state. These are very strategic pieces of equipment that will go to where they're needed the most.
Okay, with the number of cases recorded, is the country still managing imported cases and their primary contacts, or have we crossed over to community transmission?
So, yes, a lot of our initial cases were people that have come back. The number of cases that have a travel history is definitely reducing. But there are still people coming in from our land borders. One of the big clusters in one of the states is actually people that came back through a land border, and there have been a few of them. So the numbers have come down from that source. What is happening now, most of the newest cases are people that have either contacted it from a known confirmed case, so a contact of a case that has now become a positive himself or herself. And yes, we do have about 30% of all our cases at the moment don't have an obvious source of that infection. So that could be two things. Firstly, you could be a contact of a case and you didn't know the person had the disease. Or there could be some community transmission going on. So over the next few days, we will understand this a little bit more. And that will then define our response. You know, in our case definition, we have three categories. One are people with symptoms that have had a history of travel. That's almost close to zero now. The next one is people that have with symptoms that have contact with a confirmed case. The third category is people with acute respiratory infections for which there's no other obvious explanation. That third category is going to be the focus of our work over the next week. We will start increasing testing among people with no travel history just to be sure to understand the extent of transmission in the communities. And this is particularly important in Lagos and Abuja because it's that epidemiology, the understanding of where the cases are, that will drive a lot of the work that we're doing.
So how do we intend to do this? What's the model for
carrying out? Our model in Lagos, and this is led by the Lagos State teams, but we are supporting, is really, you know, we've split up Lagos into local government teams. So, you know, most other states would have a state team, but in Lagos, we have a team in every local government. They're going to go around their areas, their healthcare facilities, inquire about patients with an acute respiratory infection, offer them the opportunity of testing. You know, you would take a nasopharyngeal swab, it's a very simple sample to collect, and we'll go and test. And if we find more cases, we'll respond in that context, and we'll keep pushing from there.
At the time we got the first index case, I kept asking the Minister of Health, why haven't we shut our borders and our airports? If we had done this earlier, would we be battling with this?
You know, you never know. You know, we have to understand that this is a virus, right? It's a hard decision to shut off a country. And the Minister of Health can't make that decision anyway, even if he wanted to. But this is a hard decision. And even when initially we restricted travel, you know, a lot of our cases were Nigerians coming home. And you can't stop Nigerians from coming home. This is their country. So even though we stopped the flights, many people are coming in through the land borders. If a Nigerian gets to the border, you have to let him in. And unfortunately, the virus doesn't look at your passport to see whether you're Nigerian or not. So those are very difficult decisions. And every country in the world right now is struggling with lockdowns. Every country. Because there's a price to pay. Yes, we need to control this outbreak. But yes, you know, there is a price to pay. And sometimes the cure can become even worse than the disease. Because in locking down your country, you stop people going out for medical care, you stop medical equipment coming in. You know, there are all sorts of consequences, both on the health side and the economic side. So it's not an easy decision. So I would give the leadership a little bit of credit in making these hard decisions on our behalf.
Okay, you talked about how the team is trying, the response team is trying to up their game, especially with going from house to house to look at people with respiratory stuff. So now many Nigerians are asking, how many ventilators and critical care beds do we have to manage our patients?
So no doubt this is an area that we didn't invest enough in over the past 20, 30 years. You know, the number of ICU beds in the country are definitely not sufficient for the country this size. ICU beds and ventilators are complex pieces of equipment. I call them ICU beds because a ventilator in itself is not going to save anybody's life. You know, it's not a plug and play piece of equipment. You need to really understand how to use it, how to intubate, how to get it to work on patients for it to be useful. So there's been a lot of focus on it. And yes, we take our hands up, we haven't invested enough in this, just like many aspects of our health sector. And we're learning a lot of lessons. I think the most important thing now is to focus on the benefits of the investments that are being made, the support that is coming in, our own government is spending now, that we have a view absolutely on the short term to get ahead of this outbreak, because that's our primary goal. But everything we're doing now has to leave us in a better place at the end of the outbreak. And the Honorable Minister of Health is so focused on this that he wants the entire health sector to benefit from this crisis. We mustn't miss this opportunity. Yes, it's a crisis, but every crisis is an opportunity. And as we build to respond to this, we must build for the future. And that's what we're doing.
Okay, now let's go to Africa. Looking at the Africa space now, there's been report that Africa may not be able to contain this virus because of this factor you just mentioned, our fragile health system. Do you think that African countries have fared well in tackling this virus?
So it's early days to say how well we have fared. You know, one issue where there's no doubt about at all is if I was part of the Ebola response in 2014-15, if I think about where we were as a continent then versus where we are now, we are light years ahead. You know, we have the Africa Center for Disease Control that pulls us together. We developed testing capacity in weeks across Africa. You know, when you see cases arising in Nigeria, it's because the testing is happening. It's happening here. You know, we're training ourselves. We're sharing information. We are active participants in our own future. This is the first outbreak that we're being scrutinized as much. And we're doing a great job. Yes, we're not where we want to be. We understand how where we'd like to be. But we also see a lot of countries that we have looked up to as the gold standard. They are all struggling. You know, we watch them on TV every day we go home. We don't watch them we watch them in humility, knowing our own challenges, knowing how hard we have to work because we don't have those resources. We can't order for thousands of ventilators. You know, we can't suddenly recruit 1,000 doctors from the military. We just don't have them. So we have to work within our means. But what we have in Nigeria and in many other African countries is the resilience, the African spirit that keeps us going, that keeps us awake. And, you know, we will not stop because we want to write a different story for our continent. And we're going to do this.
Okay, writing a different story would mean keeping people alive on the continent. Yeah. We have a thriving population, young population, that would add value to our economy. And by doing that, we have to keep them alive. And keeping them alive is checking COVID-19. So when people die, of COVID-19, what guidelines have been put in place to bury them? Do we allow them? Do we give them back to their families? Or what is being done?
So we are absolutely committed to keeping people alive, right? But we can't do that on our own. When I talk about the African spirit, I'm not actually just referring to the healthcare workers and those of us on this side, because especially for this disease, we need everyone on board. I will get to your question, Doshima.
Okay.
We need everyone on board to keep us alive. And yes, you know, there will be a few deaths. We've had 7 already in Nigeria. Very unfortunate. Most of them have had comorbidities. We will carry out a safe burial, advise the family on what to do. We have clear guidelines for that. But we go beyond the guidelines. We support the family, counsel them, we'll stay with them and make sure that they feel supported as they bury their dead.
Now, do the dead still carry the virus?
No, so this is a little bit different from, you know, what we know about Ebola and Lassa. Now, we haven't fully understood transmissibility among people that have passed on, but we know that it's not the same. The virus is not spread to sweat, the same way it happens with Ebola. So the risk is not, there's a respiratory virus. So most of the time, the risk is not as much. But the details, remember, we've known about this virus for 4 months. So there's still a lot to learn.
Okay. Now, if you're talking about us upping our testing capacity, if we up our testing capacity, or we discover that we are on the level of community transmission already and it blows up, how prepared are we?
We're getting more prepared. We're by the day. Every single day, my confidence increases that we're in a better place. And really, that's the most important thing. We're not where we want to be, but every single day, we have healthcare workers, public health workers across the country. Right now, as we speak, we have 17 NCDC teams, sometimes up to 20, supporting every state in Nigeria where there are cases. Sometimes big teams. But not just them. They go there, they get other people, they form a strong team, they carry out contact tracing, support the lab, support the family psychologically. So, you know, that's what keeps us going. This is our job, and, you know, we'll keep pushing.
Yeah, we're seeing your hard work, but many Nigerians are saying that those are the front line, the nurses, the doctors, and others, medical experts, don't have the required equipment. Their PPEs are not available. Many of them are not paid their hazard allowance. How are you tackling that?
So nobody managing COVID-19 in Nigeria today has not been supported with the infection prevention and control equipment. We've made sure there hasn't been any stock out so far, and we pray there isn't, because supplying Nigeria is not simple. You know, we've kept this supply chain going, both proactively in terms of people that haven't had cases. Every state, every teaching hospital, every FMC in Nigeria got a, what we call a starter pack of IPC materials. Then once you have a case, that starter pack is to enable you react for your first few days. Once you have a case, then we'll give you a significant supply to carry on. So healthcare workers are being supported. You know, the details of hazard allowance here and there, that's really for the state government, the federal government in some circumstances today, but that's really not my area of key expertise. My role is to make sure the public health response is working and people are equipped and supplied with infection prevention and control commodities to protect themselves. Listen, healthcare workers, we can't do this without the front lines, the nurses, the doctors. I'm in touch with many of them personally. The lead in Abuja, we speak all the time. So, but, you know, across the country, we really have to support our healthcare workers and make sure that they're well protected to do the critical work they do on our behalf.
Okay, and we've seen the various centers, especially Lagos and Abuja, discharge patients. But we've seen more cases being discharged in Lagos than Abuja. Mm. Are the two states using different treatment protocols, or what's happening?
There are no different treatment protocols. A lot of this, you know, the numbers are small. Firstly, Lagos has more cases, so they will discharge more. Secondly, the duration of people staying positive and infected is very variable. Our shortest positivity in a case, I think, was 5 days. Our longest was 23 days, and then the most were about 15, 16, 17 days. So there's, by some random variation, you'll have more here and there. And so there's no difference in the treatment protocols. We're doing exactly the same things generally. But remember that clinicians would have some flexibility in how they manage cases in different centers.
Okay, we are coming to the end of our program, but let me take these two last questions. There are allegations that some states are covering up some suspected cases. How true is this?
I hope it's not true. I mean, there's absolutely no point in covering up cases, because this is a virus. If I don't know how you'll cover it up, it will be transmitted to other people. Eventually, it will come out. So I think the key thing is to really encourage people that think they might be infected for one reason or the other to come forward. We will come to you. We will take a sample. And if you are positive, we will manage you. You know, 95-96% of people will recover and get back to life normally. So this is not the end of the world for anyone that's infected. And we encourage all Nigerians to, you know, do the right thing.
I know you've said so much about face masks. Please, can you tell our audiences what is the country's policy at the moment on face masks?
Yeah, so we don't have a policy, but there will become one. We're just finalizing it. But, you know, the key thing to remember about face masks is it will never be, even if we do recommend face masks, it will be in addition to everything else we've been saying about social distancing, avoiding mass gatherings, about respiratory etiquette. You know, it's not going to change any of that. The face mask is not going to suddenly, it's not like a bulletproof vest that protects you from bullets when you're shot. You know, it's part of a complete package that you will need to do all together. But really, Doshima, it's important for Nigerians to know this and people around the world. The most important thing with masks is to make sure the healthcare workers have the demand, have the supplies that they need. And that's the most, I stand in solidarity with them. I want to make sure that every mask that we have at NCDC goes to where they're needed the most. They're not needed most on my face. They're needed most on the faces of those healthcare workers. And until we can meet that demand, the priority will still be our healthcare workers.
Well, the priority on face masks is our health workers. But yeah, we're getting to the end of the program. Can you just tell us what would be your closing remarks to Nigerians, those watching you right now?
Yeah, my closing remarks to Nigerians and to anyone watching really is that this is a new virus. You know, we're learning every day. We don't have all the wisdom we need to respond, but we're doing our very best. And when I say we, it's a large community of people, and we need everyone's support along this journey as we push hard every morning to make sure that we can get ahead of this curve and get back to life as normal.
Okay, I know that some of you have been putting out your questions and asking various questions, but because of want of time, we'll not be able to take your question. But we'll be doing this program. It's a scheduled program. We'll be coming up with other health officials in Nigeria and other parts of Africa to bring you latest measures being put in place by countries across the continent in tackling COVID-19. That's the much we can take on our program today. Thank you very much for watching. Goodbye. Ẹ̀gbọ́n kílà àrùn coronavirus ní ṣe pẹ̀lú ìmọ̀ ẹ̀rọ 5G. Lórí ẹ̀rọ ìkànsíra ẹni káàkiri láti rìn táwọn ènìyàn sọ pé nínú ìtàkùn ayélujára 5G ló ń fa àrùn coronavirus. Ó yẹ ẹ̀gbọ́n kí ni ìtàkùn 5G? Ìtàkùn ayélujára 5G ń lo afẹ́fẹ́ láti mú ìgbáyégbádùn bá àwọn ènìyàn tó bá ń lo ẹ̀rọ ìbánisọ̀rọ̀ láti fi lè gba àwọn nǹkan kalẹ̀ látòjú ayélujára. Tẹ́ ẹ bá wá wò dáadáa láti 2G láti lọ sí 3G tá a tún lọ 4G tó fi wádà 5G. Bí àwọn ìtàkùn tó ti wà síwájú rẹ̀, afẹ́fẹ́ ni ìtàkùn 5G ń bá ṣiṣẹ́. Àwọn onímọ̀ sáyẹ́ǹsì sọ pé irú afẹ́fẹ́ yìí kò lágbára láti ṣe ìjàm̀bá fún àwọn sẹ́ẹ̀lì ara. Àwọn ẹ̀yà ara mìíràn tó ń dènà àrùn. Nítorí náà, àjọ elétò ìlera lágbàáyé WHO ní ìtàkùn 5G kò lágbára tó bẹ́ẹ̀ tó fi lè wọnú ara ènìyàn láti lọ fa àrùn coronavirus. Kí a tó wá máa lọ, ìmọ̀ràn wa tò ní ìrètí. Ẹnikẹ́ni bá ní kó mú nọ́mbà ilé ìfowópamọ́sí rẹ wá kíjọba lè fún ọ lówó. Má dá wọn lóhùn o, ṣèwádìí dáadáa lọ́wọ́ ìjọba àtàwọn ilé-iṣẹ́ ìròyìn tó dá tọ́. Kò tó gbégbèsẹ̀ kankan. Ẹ̀rántí kẹ́ ẹ fọwọ́ yín nígbàkúùgbà.